So my name is Mark Beebe. I'm one of the pastors here at Cokesbury. I do a lot of work with recovery on Thursday nights. And man, it's good to be with you. I want to talk about the garment of praise today and a couple of different coats we're going to get into story-wise. And man, I wanted to start off with welcoming people that are joining us online. Say hi to them. And glad to be with you. If you guys that are joining us online have questions about what's going on at Cokesbury or what some of your needs might be, you can text somebody while you're in the middle of the message. You'll see a way to be able to communicate with someone that's following along with you on our staff, and they'll be able to help you end up in the right direction with how to get that question or need answered. So the garment of praise. So there's a guy. First book of the Bible, very important book, Genesis is the name of it, 37th chapter that shows up, and his name is Jacob. And Jacob has several sons, and then along the way he has sort of like the surprise, right? Like the surprise son. So this son is much younger than his other brothers. In fact, works for a couple of the brothers, and that's how we'll get into the story. So it says, so Jacob settled again in the land of Canaan where his father had lived as a foreigner. This is the account of Jacob and his family. When Joseph, the youngest son, was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flocks. He worked for his half-brothers, the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpha. But Joseph reported to his father some of the bad things his brothers were doing. Jacob loved Joseph more than any of his other children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day, Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful robe. But his brothers hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of him. In fact, they couldn't say a kind word about him. So I want to ask you, who here, you don't have to raise your hand, but I mean, obviously, who here, if I were to say to you, who's the favorite in your family? Would it be you? And who here would be the opposite of the favorite in the family, right? Like, who here you know for a fact that if I ask your other siblings, if you have other siblings, are you the golden child? They would say yes. And if I said to you, do your other siblings sort of know you as the black sheep? You would say yes, or maybe somewhere in between. I know that my wife, Carol, her brothers, when I first met them, when we were all first getting to know each other, even before we got married, they're like, yeah, you know, like, you need to kind of be careful, Mark, because, like, the closer you get to Carol, I mean, it's kind of like she is the princess of our family. And her brothers would tell me stories like, she was the only one that got her own bathroom. They all had to live in the basement where there was no bathroom, just a shower. And they had to live with the rats and what other creatures were down there. No HVAC, you know, like, it was a tough story. And I was like, this is just the way, you know, it goes. I mean, like, I'm going, I got a lot of sisters. I'm going, they're just telling me the stories you tell, the archetypal pattern or whatever of the stories of having bratty little sister. Except, like, the more I got to know their family and the more I got to know Carol's dad and the more I watched him interact with Carol, I'll be danged if she really wasn't a favorite. Amen? It's like pretty much in every way, you know, and like I've had to like go to the brothers, yeah, y'all kind of got that right. And it's hard when it seems like somebody in your family, right, can like do no wrong. In the case of this story of Joseph, you know, the brothers, there's two things going on. Number one, the brothers are like, that kid gets the favor of our dad just because of his birth order. And then to make it worse, the kid rats him out. So it's like the kid already has an advantage, and now he rats him out and makes it worse. And then to make it worse than that, their dad goes and has this coat made just for Joseph. So like the coat, obviously in the story, you know, like it represents 100% the approval of the father, and Joseph gets it right away just for being Joseph, and the brothers don't get diddly. The brothers just keep working. The brothers just keep trying to find some way to get some level of approval. If they work hard enough, do things well enough, maybe their dad will love them the way he loves the bratty little brother, Joseph. The thing about that story is it's so tough. Is there's just one coat. Isn't that right? There's just one coat. It's not like at the end of that story it goes, and so Jacob has this coat made for Joseph. It's perfect custom fit. It's gorgeous. You know, Joseph wears it around. And then along the way, he plans to give to the brothers their own coats. It's like, nope. In this story, there's just one coat. We're going to read another story where the outcome is entirely different. But in this story, there's just one coat, right? Just one. I want you to think of the resentment of that. And I want you to think of the resentment of the fact that he is ratting out the brothers to make it worse. And it doesn't take long for those brothers to find some kind of a way to eliminate the problem. They put Joseph in a pit somewhere along the way in this story, take the coat, eliminate the coat. They can't really bring themselves to kill him, so they sell him into slavery. And he flourishes in slavery. Go figure. And the brothers have to come back to him as you read into this story down the line and deal with him again. Like if you read beyond the 37th chapter, it is some kind of a story that goes on down the line. But that story right there, all the stories of the Old Testament have much bigger consequences and outcomes than just the story itself, right? They're trying, it's kind of like fables, except they were true stories. A fable, Aesop's fables or whatever, Gulliver's Travels, whatever it's going to be, always tells you a much bigger story about life than the story itself, right? That's what this kind of a story is about. And so that deal of not knowing how to get approval from God and believing that you got to find some way to kind of earn it because there's only one coat and there's only select people that God is going to have his favor with takes us to a storyline down the road where the people of God have decided that maybe in order to get God's approval and to be sure of it and to be content in it, they are going to try to become more like God. And so they decide what they're going to do is they're going to build a tower that they call, that's eventually called the Tower of Babel. And the Tower of Babel is going to rise up. It's going to be very high. It's going to be so high, it's going to move you up to what their idea of the heavens were. And when you get it tall enough, you're going to be able to look God, you're going to be able to look God right in the eye. And when you can look God right in the eye and you've done all this work and created all this accomplishment and done all this hard stuff, all this engineering, all of that for this, then God is going to pay attention to you. Except the problem was that wasn't the way that God wanted to love his people. It wasn't going to be by their accomplishment or by their performance. It was going to be by his heart. It was going to be by his heart. And so God, what he does is, while they're in the middle of building this monstrosity, he decides he's going to confuse the language of all the people that are working on this project. Up until this point, the language was the same. So now this project, which is a failure because people can't communicate, they can't engineer it anymore, they can't build it anymore, it's now called the Tower of Babel because they couldn't talk to each other and the project fails. But there are outcomes, there are dilemmas that come from Babel. And so here are what some of them are. Number one, I will get myself a name from the work of my hands and from the recognition of others. If there's only one coat, and if God only outright loves his favorites, and if God only loves select people, like, you know, like, do you know people like that? I'm sure you do, right? You know somebody in your life right now that it seems like everything they do turns to gold, right? They have the best vacations. They consistently get upgraded to first class. They consistently get in the short line at the Walmart, which now I found out the Walmart in Turkey Creek, there ain't gonna be anybody you're waiting on because it's all gonna be self-service checkout. The worst thing I could possibly imagine for Mark Beebe, but because I hate it. Like, I don't know why they can't just take your money. But anyway, that's a whole different deal. But we could talk about that a while, but it's a different deal. But that they always seem to get in the fastest line. They never seem to they get stopped for speeding. The cop lets them go. Do you know that person? Their team always seems to win the Super Bowl. Who knows what, I mean, like, but they just seem to be that person that, like, has a fortunate side to them that won't quit. And then there's the rest of us. And how do we get there? Well, maybe we earn it. I will get myself a name from the work of my hands and from the recognition of others. This will make me one of great worth and value. And the formula for that is this: self-worth equals performance plus the opinion of others. My self-worth, the way I know myself, the way I value myself, the way I care for myself, the way I see myself, is based on performance and the opinion of others. And so there are quote-unquote benefits that come out of this experience of Babel. And here's what they are. Number one, I must meet certain standards to feel good about myself. I don't want you, like, you think about, like, go back to Christmas. How was Christmas dinner for you? If you were the cooker, if you were the chef of Christmas dinner, how did it go? Did it go well? Was it served on time? Did people get what they wanted? How were you as the gift giver? How many gifts did you have to take back? How many home runs did you hit as the gift giver? How did you do? Were people happy? If everybody came to your house, did it all go well? Were you able to modify and mitigate and sort of smooth over the standard Christmas Day arguments that siblings or other family members kind of have with each other walking into your house? How did that all go? How did you feel about Christmas? I must feel good. I must meet certain standards to feel good about myself. I must be approved of by certain others in my life to feel good about myself. How many people right now of us, just us, continue to struggle with the reality that my mom simply doesn't see me as being a complete and competent wife or mother or caregiver for my children or worker or whatever. And I can't quite get my mom to ever say to me, man, you're really doing some, I'm just proud of you. You're doing some great things as a mom. You're really doing some good things, you know, in your marriage. Really respect you. You're 40 years old and you've never been able to hear that from your mom. You're 40 years old and you've never been able to hear from your dad anything like that, I'm proud of you, son. I'm proud of you. And you're searching for it, and you're striving for it, and you're kind of daily emotionally begging for it, but inside of you, you're really not sure at all. As a matter of fact, you're more sure that it's never gonna come than the possibility that it would come. I must be approved of by certain others to feel good about myself. Those who fail, this is number three, those who fail are unworthy of love, even the love of God, and deserve to be punished. That's kind of like that Christian karma stuff, right? I do something that's rebellious or whatever toward God, and guess what? God's coming to get me. I wrong God, God's gonna wrong me, because that's the way we do it. There's nothing biblical about that. That is simply the opposite of the gospel of the cross of Jesus. But man, we are very wary in that pattern of whatever I do to God, God's gonna return the favor to me. Those who fail are unworthy of love and deserve to be punished, even by God. And then last, I am the person that I am. I am the man that I am. I am the woman that I am. And I deserve to be punished. And also, I am worthless. And I cannot change. There is, like, how much of a conflict does that statement produce with the counter of resurrection or transformation in Jesus? I want you to hear those four statements. And then I want you to hear out of the gospel this statement. While I was yet broken, while I was yet in my sin, while I was yet in my failure, while I was yet being told that I was never going to be a good son, while I was being told I was never going to be the right kind of daughter, while I was being told I was never going to be the right kind of child, while I was being told I was never going to be the right kind of husband, while I was being told I was never going to be the right kind of wife, while I was being told I was never going to be the right kind of worker, while all that was going on, Jesus died for me. Not after I got that fixed, but right then. Jesus died for me right then. Right when all that was going on. Right when I was feeling like a failure. Right when I was looking for somebody else's approval. When the approval that I needed was right there in the good news of Jesus. But I wouldn't take it. And so now, that Babel dilemma, what it does is it causes other voices in my life to have dominance in my thoughts and in my heart. And that no good, no good, no good, not good enough, never gonna be good enough, can't measure up, can't win the award, can't get to the performance that's gonna create approval for me, can't get there with God or anybody else, can't get there because, see, if I got there with God, if I could get to a place with God where I knew my value with God and I knew the way that God loved me, everything else in my life changes. Amen? And if I don't get there with God, I'm gonna struggle in some way or another with every other relationship that is in my life. I am what I am. I cannot change. I'm worthless. The transformational authority of Jesus is not active in my life. The resurrection of Jesus is not available to me. Or if it is, it's only gonna become available when I die. And that's tough. It's tough because I am giving those kinds of unhealthy, destructive voices in my life full authority. And I'm saying for the rest of my days, I'm like, yeah, but I remember that. I mean, I remember that story of Joseph. There's one coat, one blessing. And guess what? Joseph got it. Mark Beebe didn't get it. You didn't get it. Joseph got it. There's still only one coat. And that's the destiny of this. And that's what all those other opinions about you coming from other people that are not healthy or helpful or in any way representing Jesus for you, that's where they land us. Amen? I remember a time in my life where I felt exactly this way. When it was going on was when my first wife was struggling mightily with the disease of alcoholism. And it had become so difficult on the daily that over a stretch of time, I convinced myself and even talked to other family members about the fact that it would be better for my children to be living with some other family member because it would at least help them to not be in the middle of so much chaos. I even floated the idea to a couple of family members and some close friends. Every family member told me it would be a huge mistake. Your kids, they need you. My friends told me, your kids, they need you. You're their dad. Man, I was convinced. And so somewhere in that stretch of 3-4 weeks when that was going on, I had this dream. And I don't know about you, like I rarely have dreams that I remember. And I might have some kind of a light dream that I might remember something about, maybe, but normally I really don't also remember dreams. But I remember this one. And in this dream, I don't know where I was, and I cannot for the life of me tell you what God in this dream actually looked like, but like I knew it was God. And so he's talking to me, and he's holding this coat. And this coat is like, man, like it's like exquisite, like it's gorgeous, and it's bright, and it's just beautiful. And God's going, look at Mark. I want you to. We're gonna have to change the coat you're wearing, because the coat you're wearing is gonna take you to a place where you're never gonna be sure of yourself. You're never going to feel fully loved. You're never going to feel accepted. You're never going to feel secure. You're not going to be able to function as a parent, because now there's a lot of voices pressing into you about how much of a failure you feel like. How much of a failure you feel like as a spouse, that you can't bring about any kind of healing in your wife's disease, which at that point, I still thought I should have somehow been able to know how to do. And you're just not going to be able to be there for your kids. So he goes, we got to switch coats. I want you to put this coat on. So I put it on, and he goes, you know what? I want you to promise me that you're going to wear this coat every day from now until the day you die, and you're never going to leave your house. You're never going to start a day. You're never going to do anything without it. You're never going to do it again. And you're never going to replace my coat with anybody else's. And that is what I remember about that dream. About 2.5 weeks later, some people that were in the same church that we were planting in Hilton Head, we all were going to a worship service once a month in Charleston at a place called Seacoast Church. So they had this service that they called First Wednesdays. So we go there. And not the first song that night, but the second song that night, it is by a guy named Robin Marks. And Robin Marks is an Irish worship leader. And the name of that song was The Garment of Praise. And the whole song was about putting on the garment of praise. What I just want to read you from Isaiah 61. This is where it comes from. To comfort all who mourn and provide for those who grieve in Zion, to bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. And once you put on that garment, God goes, you will be called oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor. Once you put on this garment of praise, God is saying, and leave it on and never leave, start a day, leave your home without it, start a day without it, end a day without it. Once you put it on, you're going to be rooted in so much love and so much affection and so much security and so much approval and so much worth that you're not going to know what to do without it. There's a guy that wrote a book that I'm going to actually get into in 4 or 5 weeks on Thursday night. The name of this book is called Search for Significance. And it's by a guy named Robert McGee. And McGee takes that scripture and that understanding of what it is that I understand myself to be valued by. And he says, the longer you go with trying to create value based on performance, the more afraid, unhappy, insecure you're going to get. But if you will allow God to show you your worth in Jesus, your value in Jesus, your pricelessness in Jesus, if you will allow God to show you that in Jesus, Jesus said, you are worthy of my death on a cross, everything about the way you see your work life, your marriage, your children, your parenting, your friendships, all of it's going to change. Because you're going to have a bedrock, you're going to have a base that you probably don't have right now. So I want you to remember, you remember the statements I made, right, about the Babel dilemmas, right, and all those statements. Now I want you to hear McGee's. McGee says, as a result of God putting on that garment of praise for me, that he fashioned for me, and that garment of praise, there was only one coat for Joseph. There are billions of these garments of praise, enough for everybody in the world, enough for everybody to have one. And they're all tailor-made to fit us all perfectly. If you will put on that garment, McGee says, here's what's going to happen. You're going to realize that I am deeply loved. You're going to realize that I am fully pleasing. You're going to realize that I am totally forgiven. You're going to realize that I am totally accepted. You're going to realize that I am complete in Jesus. The only way those pieces of freedom are going to show up for us is if we allow God to give us the garment of praise that we need right now. Like there isn't going to be some other way. There isn't enough work we can do. There isn't enough success we can have. There isn't enough opportunity for us to prove to God that we're okay. It's got to be this coat. It's got to be what God's going to do in Jesus. Jesus keeps talking about us having an abundant life. He keeps talking about us having a free life. He keeps talking about us having a full life. Man, the way to get it is to know the coat that you're wearing. It's the garment of praise. Listen, thanks so much for being here today. In Jesus' sweet name, amen.